Alive.
What's happening, people? I'm here with the main man.
It's the champ. Make
sure you tune into Pep Talk UK, where it's talks boxing and
big up, big up, big up, big up.
Thank you, AJ. Pep Talk UK. Oi, oi! Welcome to the Pep Talk UK Sports Podcast, the podcast that talks the major boxing and football news from around the globe. Real points of view from a real panel. Hashtag Real Talk on Pep Talk. Please subscribe to Pep Talk UK on iTunes and YouTube. Don't forget to like, share, and comment. Now, I'm your host, Frankie B, and I'm joined by a sick panel. Firstly, I'd like to welcome back from the capital city of France, Paris, but now resident in the home counties, is Pascal. How you doing, brother?
Oh, I'm very, very well. Jusqu'ici, tout va bien. Another week, and I'm very glad to be here, my friend. Very glad.
Yes. Did you hear the breaking news this week? James DeGale signing with Frank Warren, mate.
It's controversial, you know. It's a very controversial move. It's a bit like when Saul Campbell went to Tottenham.
I'm telling you.
For all Tottenham personnel, sorry. Yes, or when even worse, when Adebayo went to Tottenham, knowing that he was an ex-Arsenal player, you know. So it's an interesting one, but you know, it's James again, probably believes that he needs a change in his career. And you know, Frank Warren, he's a proven veteran in the game, you know, let's not knock him, he's very good at what he does. So, you know, there must be some
reason. Must be very good, because he hasn't aged. All the time I've seen him on TV, he hasn't aged one bit, mate.
He's got a good plastic surgeon, hasn't he? You know, he's got that nip tuck.
Must use a bit of tea tree. Yeah. Must be use a bit of tea tree from the body shop, mate.
All of you, lay, of course. Yeah. You know, bit of makeup.
But more importantly, he's got a fantastic squad of fighters now. You're looking at Triple D, Daniel Dubois, Dynamite Triple D, shall I say? Anthony Yard, Lee Selby. Mate, the list goes on. That is one hell of a roster.
It's as you boys say in England, the squad is very thick, you know, big squad, you know, very dense. Shout out to Lee Fobizol. You know, there's a lot of people there that could cause a lot of trouble in any way division. So he's certainly, you know, galvanizing himself a very good team, a very good prospect. So he's going to be an interesting one to watch, you know, very much so.
Indeed.
Very much so.
Indeed. Now, Pascal, we're going to keep it moving. You want to shout your social media out?
Oui, bien sûr. My social media is Pascal_DeSade, and you can find me at Instagram and on Twitter.
Cracking. Right, now it's time to welcome one of the Pep Talk boys. It's MJ the Red. How you doing, Geese?
Frankie B, MJ in the building. Absolutely disgusted still. I think I said 2 weeks ago when I was last on the pod, I was more worried about my gardener who'd stolen my shovel, and I exposed him on this podcast. I wanted to return that shovel because it's difficult for me to start my gardening. But then again, look at what happens to my football team. Liverpool, the city of Liverpool in general, is absolutely suffering. You've got Everton, they're taking L's left, right and centre, and actually sacking and looking for a new manager. And then we've got Brendan Klopp, I believe. That's what everyone's calling him now. Yeah. Jurgen Klopp is now merged with Brendan Rodgers to give us Brendan Klopp. This guy who has a shambolic record, can't seem to get teams to defend, and it's not going well, mate. It's really not.
But he was meant to be your saviour at one point, though. When he came to Liverpool, he was meant to be the messiah.
Well, to be honest, we've had so many false prophets. over at Liverpool, you know, I mean, at the moment, it's really make and break for Jurgen Klopp. He really has to deliver. If not, I think he might be showing the door sooner rather than later. But you know what? Looking forward to discussing this, as well as all the exciting points in football, as well as boxing, with everyone on the pod today.
Indeedy. Now, MJ, you want to shout out your social media?
Absolutely. Social media is my Instagram, like_Mike28, and on Twitter, find me on there, MJ, Pep Talk UK, Pep Talk Boy, you can find me on there as well. Send me abuse. I'd rather you didn't. I'd rather you send me some nice stuff, but most importantly, let's have some interaction. Let's discuss.
Yeah, MJ the Red. Right, finally, we'd like to welcome a footballer who's played for Coventry and Gillingham, but now he's at Kingstonian. It's our guy, Donovan Simmons. How you doing, bro?
Hi, Frankie B. Thank you for having me, my brother. How are you?
Yeah, I'm all good. I'm good, mate. If I'm not mistaken, probably our first footballing guest on the show, on a live show, that is. So what's been happening? What's your assessment of the season so far of Kingstonian?
Well, I've literally just left Kingstonian.
Wow, literally.
Like a week ago.
Wow.
Yes. There's a few issues. This kind of happens in part-time football, lower leagues, you know. The budget's very, very short.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't have a lot of money for players. And, you know, there's a lot of players that come and go. So for me, I didn't feel too comfortable there around, not the players or the manager, just the surroundings and everything else. And I thought it was best for me to leave and look elsewhere.
Wow. So
that's where I'm at the moment.
So you've done the same thing that Sanchez is going to do at Arsenal, right?
No, Sanchez needs to stay where he is. Yeah. As I'm an Arsenal fan, Sanchez, he's doing so well for the Gunners. So hopefully he stays.
Yeah, hopefully. Now moving on to, I know you do a lot of things on the side as well as football. You hear that you're shooting a documentary. Do you want to tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, that's correct. Basically, I work with a company called Redeeming Features. They're a production company. At the moment, we're shooting a feature documentary on an ex-footballer, now ex-boxer, Leon McKenzie.
Yeah.
Basically, the documentary is about Leon's life. You know, the pressures of being a footballer from such a young age. You know, you've been thrown in the deep end. You know, you're a professional and you become an idol to the public world.
Mm-hmm.
So, Leon's gone through loads of ups and downs. He suffers mental health, depression.
Yeah. This is real.
So he's been through lots of ups and downs, injuries, and, you know, I don't want to give too much away, but the documentary is going to be amazing. So basically, it's just going out there, finding people, you know, that's been in the sporting world. There's people that, you know, that have done well in their career, and once their career comes to an end, they're kind of lost.
Yeah,
it's like now they're in the real world, and it's like, what do I do now? You know, life after football, life after boxing. So it's just going out there, talking to ex-boxers, footballers, athletes, you know, and seeing where they're at in life, and, you know, hopefully we can interview a few people that have gone through, you know, mental health issues. I know we have Frank Bruno on the documentary.
Wow.
So it's looking exciting. It's still a work in progress, but it's looking great.
Johnny Nelson on there from Sky?
Johnny Nelson's on there.
My
yes.
Yeah.
Johnny Nelson, Jamie Redknapp, Dame Kelly Holmes, and a few more people. A few more, to be fair.
That's quite a stacked lineup, mate, in the documentary. So when's it likely to be broadcasted?
We're looking May time, and hopefully it's going to be on Netflix. So that's what we're trying to do at the moment, trying to get onto Netflix and everything else. But
yeah, we look forward to it, indeedy. Now, Don, do you want to shout out your social media as we move on?
All right, my social media, I'm only on Instagram, so it's at DonSim01, so DonSim01.
Cracking stuff. Make sure you look out for the documentary, yeah? Don Simmons, my chi.
And the documentary is called 10 Count.
Nice.
Just so that you know.
Yeah, cracking stuff. Right, we're going to move on to the boxing. Ladies and gents, for the fight fans locked in. For the football fans locked in. Now it's time for some real talk on Pep Talk. Let's go. Yes, we ready. Let's get into it. It's real talk. It's Pep Talk. So we're going to start with the boxing. And the biggest draw in boxing right now, Anthony Joshua, is in action at the Principality Arena in Cardiff, defending his IBF, WBA and IBO straps against Carlos Takam this weekend. Now Pascal, AJ spent weeks preparing for the style of Pulev, but at late notice has to readjust his style to fight a much shorter fighter, a much shorter come forward fighter in Carlos Takam. But will this affect AJ in any way?
Well, you know, AJ is a professional, and you know, he's got a good amateur record, he's got a good Olympic record also, and in my opinion, he can adjust to any style. Certainly, we will see on Saturday whether he shows the level of professionalism that we expect from him. But I'm not too concerned about Anthony Joshua. I believe that he's been there before. You know, he's fought majority of his career. He's been in the ring with quite a lot of smaller guys. You know, so in terms of the adjustments, he will be fine. He will be absolutely fine. What he will certainly be surprised is the bravery that Carlos Takam will show, because as I said before, Carlos is a one track minded individual. He's the kind of guy you need when you go to a nightclub. He looks at the price and he goes for it. He will be a good wingman, because he's very relentless and he comes forward all the time. So I expect the fight to be explosive. He will not last very long, but I guarantee you that it will be a very explosive fight, because Carlos is certainly the kind of boxer that he's not very good at fighting off the back foot. He only knows one way, and one way is forward for him. And, and we will get to see whether, Anthony Joshua can adjust to that style. You know, he may well be a bit surprised by it, because, in the heavyweight division, we know that one punch is everything. And for him to be in the ring with a come forward fighter like that, he may well be surprised. But I expect the fight to be quite entertaining, especially for Carlos, because even though I expect Carlos to lose, Carlos may well potentially put himself in other fights opportunities in the UK, where people can maybe sign in for other fights, because there's a lot of talent here in Great Britain. So it could be good for Carlos as well to line up other fights for him.
But Joshua as well, he's used to going forward on his opponents, to see Takam march forward on him, it might surprise him. You never know.
I believe it will surprise him. I believe it will. But, Carlos has a good enough record, but he's certainly not as polished and not as, and certainly not as young as Anthony Joshua is. So, he's in his mid 30s. He's taking a lot of punishment in the game.
36, yeah.
I believe that that will eventually take its toll during the fight anyway. He's no Vladimir Klitschko. Though he's a talented fighter, he doesn't have that same level of pedigree. So, I expect Anthony Joshua to do what he's supposed to do. He will go out there, he will perform and do a good job, but he needs to be careful, and he certainly should not do Hassan Rahman against Leon Lewis.
That was a very big shock,
and we all know that these things can happen in heavyweight boxing. So AJ will have to take his fight very seriously. I've seen his training so far. He's doing very well. He's certainly concentrating and applying himself like he always does. But, as long as there is no stupid showboating, or he goes out there and performs and meant to do what he's supposed to do, we should see AJ retaining all the belts.
Yes, indeed. I'm going for round 5. What's your prediction? Inside 3 rounds?
I would probably say, I think it would be quite a surprising fight for everybody. I think that I would probably say for everybody, be prepared for a good night of boxing, and I would expect it to go up to round 6 or round 7, because I think that AJ will be pleasantly surprised by this Carlos Takam. He's a French Cameroonian, so he's got that African power, and we know that AJ also carries a lot of African power in those punches, so
he'll
be pounded yam against the Cameroonian national dish, and we just have to see how well those two fare off. But it will be certainly a fight that will involve a lot of pride. The French are very prideful people. The Cameroonians also are very, very, very much a fighting spirited people. So we will expect a very flamboyant fight, in my opinion. but I expect AJ to start him in round 6, so round 7.
And he's and AJ is fighting a guy that's got nothing to lose, so that's a big factor.
For him, he's done so well, Carlos, because you know none of us expected Carlos to be you know in the running for that fight, you know, and he's been plucked out as a, and he's been considered as a good enough replacement. And he would have loved and studied you know Carlos, you know, and know that he shouldn't put too much of a problem for Anthony Joshua, but at the same time, you know, he has to entertain a lot of people at, you know, at the Principality Stadium. So he has to be an entertaining fight to be able to be on the match room, keep on promoting the Anthony Joshua brand. So I believe that it was a very good selected fight, you know, and the fight will be very explosive. Believe you me, it will be very entertaining. And for those of us, you know, who are not familiar with Carlos Takam, please look at the fight against Povetkin, Alexander Povetkin.
That's right.
You know, that was a very exciting fight when he went to Russia, and you know, the odds were stacked against him. Though he lost, he gave him a very good account of himself. So,
and some people might even argue that Takam might have edged that fight. For once, AJ is going to be punching downwards against a short pit bull terrier type of fighter in Takam. Be trying to chop down AJ's body with the body shots. How will AJ cope with this possible onslaught?
Well, you know, Frankie B, Carlos Takam is no Mike Tyson, you know. And, you know, a good Mike Tyson in his heyday will have tried to come on the beef like he always does, you know. And you will have probably expect left hook to the body and left hook to the face, followed by an uppercut, you know, which was the trademark combination of a young, hungry Mike Tyson. But Carlos Takam doesn't have the same head movement as Mike Tyson, though he's a very good body puncher, and he's also a very good thrower of the uppercut. But in the first few rounds, to try and get closer to Anthony Joshua is going to be very difficult, because Anthony Joshua will try to establish his jab very early on, most importantly. And once he gets a good range and a good understanding of Carlos Takam's movement, I think that AJ will time in really well. If one of his right hands, or certainly if one of his uppercuts, you know, lands on Carlos Takam, he will certainly be another boxer taking any, and it will be very difficult for Carlos to get back and to try and overcome Anthony Joshua. So if I was AJ, you know, what I would do is just very, you know, just be relaxed, let Carlos come forward, you know, and use my movement, use the footwork.
You don't often see AJ on the back foot boxing. You just see him rushing forward and taking his opponents out.
Of course, you rarely see that, because his opponents are very much aware of the power that he carries. But Carlos is the kind of fighter that would not really care about that. He's got nothing to lose, as we said before, and he wants to give a good account of himself. You know, I think his training camp and his trainers and his promoters will certainly urge him to be more adventurous, because this is a fight that's going to be, you know, televised and streamed all around the world. So there's an opportunity for Carlos Takam to show what he's made of. So I expect Carlos to be more direct. So I will expect AJ to do, you know, to slip a lot of the punches, to pivot a bit, you know, and to try and catch him on the counter. So it would be good to see whether AJ can show us the different facet to his boxing abilities, whether he can also be a counter puncher, or does he rely on his power? Does he rely on his ability to go forward? I believe that Saturday will show us that. But I think that AJ will be able to cope. As I said before, he's an Olympic medalist. You don't get to that level without being able to adapt and to adjust to various opponents' styles. So I expect AJ to be able to cope with Carlos Takam's forward approach, yeah. And hopefully tuck him in. You know, he should be okay.
MJ, so will Takam, will he indeed, you know, win the lottery, beat AJ and purchase a few Bugattis?
You know what, it's funny you say that, Frankie B, because what Takam's trying to do, he's actually trying to create the biggest upset in British boxing heavyweight division since one Haseem Rahman showed up and actually beat Lennox Lewis. That South is exactly Africa. What yep. He's up against. He's up against this sort of history. He's out here trying to actually remove Haseem Rahman and be the biggest upset in British boxing history in the recent time. So yeah, he's definitely up against it, but come on, I think we know we know both boxers can absolutely bang, and we know he's gonna go there as a pit bull. But you know what? That's really just gonna play to AJ's strengths. AJ has got the reach, he's got the boxing ability. It's only gonna go one way. But you know what? It's funny you say that. Will he win the lottery and buy Bugattis? The truth is, whatever happens at the Principality Stadium, the man has already won, because he's gonna actually he has already secured the bag before anything goes down.
He's already got the duffel bag.
Well, exactly. So it doesn't matter, because you know he's winning. So what's gonna happen on Saturday as a prediction? AJ is gonna win. I agree with you. We're in five. But guess who else is going to win? Tekhem as well, because he's going to take home some decent money. Everyone's going to be a winner.
Yeah, and he'll sing a bit of DJ Khaled, "All I Do Is Win, 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 No Matter What."
Exactly.
Now, Don Simmons.
Yeah.
I know you love to watch the big fight. We're not going to see an upset on Saturday night, are we? AJ is just going to blitz Tekhem and then move on to bigger and better things, surely.
Well, you know what, for Tekhem, it's a great opportunity for him. Like, it's his time to shine, basically, you know. And as we all know, in boxing or in any sport, anything can happen. You know, I think it'll be a very entertaining fight. I love the big fights, you know. I don't know loads about boxing, but I do love to watch the sport. Do you know what I mean? So for me, I thought for Tekhem, he's got nothing to lose. So he'll leave everything in the ring, 100%. But AJ...
Sometimes yeah, it's better to go away and fight against, you know, the away crowd. You know, he can just literally go out there and do his thing, and hopefully, you know, he'll hope to pick up, you know, the victory.
Yeah, of course. You know what? With the atmosphere, like, being in a boxing ring, it's just two men. Do you know what I mean? And the atmosphere, being away from home, some people like that pressure.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Spurs
them on. It spurs them on, and they, you know, just... anything can happen. But they love that. I used to love that pressure. Going away games and
away
everything
games,
else, the pressure from the away fans. It makes me play better. So for him, he's got a point to prove. You know, he wants to show the world what he's capable of doing. And, you know, he'll get his name out there even more.
Yeah, and he's just got to think of those zeros, you know, at the end of the check if he wins.
Exactly. Exactly.
And as well, good. We've also got to mention that boxers have actually appeared on this podcast have always said, when you've got your mandatory, it's always the most difficult, or when you've got a last minute. I mean, AJ was literally on cloud nine when he fought against Klitschko. I mean, to train for that, to actually go to this one, which is not as glamorous. I mean, he is going to struggle to get himself up for this one.
Yeah.
I mean, we all want to be professional, but... you know, it will be more difficult for AJ for that reason.
Right.
Yeah.
On to another man on the bill, Dillian White. He takes on Robert Hellenius for the WBC silver heavyweight title on the undercard. Now, Pascal.
Wait.
Dillian White is gunning for Deontay Wilder. And if he wins this one, he's a step closer to a possible WBC world title shot.
You know, I'm not too sure, because in my opinion, Deontay Wilder is the most protected man in boxing. For me, he's got more protection than Donald Trump as president. You know, he's
got
protected
more protection than the White House.
than the White House president. The fighters, the fights that should have happened, that have not happened, you know, have concerned a lot of people and raised a lot of eyebrows. And even if Dillian White, you know, manages to get through Saturday, I believe there will be some political decision that will allow, you know, Deontay Wilder to skip and to go somewhere else and to fight somewhere else, unfortunately.
But he's definitely capable of, you know, giving Deontay Wilder a good fight. You know, he's got a very good chin, he's very durable, he's a really tough, strong guy, you know, with good boxing fundamentals. I think he can give Wilder a good run for his money.
Absolutely, Frankie. I do have to agree with everything you said there. I mean, someone like Dillian's a bit of an enigma. I mean, unfortunately, he had the situation in which he was suspended for boxing for about 2 years. I believe had he had that 2 years of boxing back that he got for taking the substances, whatever it was. I mean, he's been cleared of that now. He's kind of served his ban. But had he actually spent that time in the ring, I believe Dillian White would probably be in a different sphere to others. He'll be another top British heavyweight boxer operating at the highest level. But it's definitely going to be an interesting one. I expect Dillian to come through it, but we'll I do agree it. With Pascal. There's so much politics, especially in and around Dillian White.
But what Dillian White is doing is he's putting himself in that position where, you know, he's going to get that ranking and become a mandatory challenger for the WBC. And Deontay Wilder have no option but to fight him.
Remember, Deontay Wilder is the last, is the only American heavyweight standing right now. So politically, there are a lot of reasons why they don't want this man to actually take some L's.
Of course.
And especially to lose before he's ready to go for that big fight. And
MJ, that's a very good
Dillian White is too dangerous for the amount of money you're going to get back for him. It's a bit like how people dodge Triple G for so many years.
Yeah, yeah. But the point I see is that, say for instance, he beats Wilder, takes the WBC, fights Joshua again. Joshua, Dillian White rematch, part two, that would be electrifying. That's a stadium filler.
You know what? The only fight that can excite me more than that would obviously be two fights. The Dillian and Joshua, or if the boy Tyson Fury comes back. If he comes back to the boxing game with Fury, apart from that, that would be a super exciting fight. That Dillian White Joshua too.
But I believe, MJ, you made some very valid points. The Americans have been wanting a heavyweight fighter for a very long time, a heavyweight champion for a very long time. Deontay Wilder is fulfilling that expectation for them. And even though he's probably not the most talented heavyweight in the history of their sport, he's certainly an American figure in the political sphere of boxing is concerned. Now, a lot of the challengers, we've seen the likes of Luis Ortiz of Cuba, you know, could have posed a threat. He's not had the opportunity to fight.
Yeah.
Alexander Povetkin, man of Russia, have not had the opportunity to fight. And Dillian White, representing Great Britain by Jamaica, also has difficulties in getting himself a fight. So, you know, in my opinion, the only fight that will happen is the Wilder Joshua. And the
promoters is a big money maker.
Know that he's a big money maker, and they were willing to take the loss if the fight can break box office records, and that's the only way that we are going. And even if Dillian White wins on Saturday, he will be given step aside money to go and fight someone else so that the fight against Joshua can actually take place. So I feel sorry for Dillian White, because, you know, even though he's doing everything that he should be doing, he would not be pushed enough by the public, nor would he be pushed enough by his promoters to make the fight, because he certainly doesn't have a big enough fan base to push ahead to get that fight against Deontay Wilder. And that's when it comes down to, is how much money can that fight make? And unfortunately, Deontay Wilder, Dillian White, doesn't sell very much. I don't believe it'll be a pay-per-view fight. It'll be a standard fight that will be streamed on illegal websites.
Hey, Pascal, you better run. Dillian White's gonna come after you, mate.
No, I like Dillian White. He's very cool, you know. I like him very much, but I feel sorry for him, because I just don't think that he's being pushed and being promoted the way he should be. But he's a good fighter. He's improving a lot. Every fight he gets better and better. But it has become more and more obvious that there are so many political strings, so many political players in this game, that he's not getting a fair share. And that fight should have taken place, you know, a long time ago. And unfortunately,
I just want to see him versus Joshua. He's got the WBC, Joshua's got his WBA and his IBF and IBO. I want to see them get on again. I want to see Stormzy, you know, do his intro again, mate. And I want to see a fantastic night of boxing, mate.
Of course. That'll be a cracking rematch.
Actually, after the last fight, I think Dillian and Stormzy, they did go back and forth, didn't they? On Twitter, social media, and videos. So just seeing part two of what happens at the aftermath of that fight would be just as exciting as actually watching the heavyweight spectacular.
But before we jump the gun, Pascal, Robert Hellenius, you know, he's only got one loss in his record. Even though he's not the most glamorous of fighters, you know, merely fought in Germany and Sweden, he's going to prove a stern test for Dillian White. You know, it's not a foregone conclusion yet.
He's very good. You know, he's a two-time, you know, European heavyweight champion. You know, he's got a good pedigree, good amateur the record he has as an amateur boxer is also very good. He can bang as well, you know, he's very good at punching, he's very strong. He's not exciting, you know, he's not particularly an exciting fighter. But, you know, believe you me that the fight will be a stern test. And in terms of experience, he's got, you know, a good record. And he'll be probably one of the better fighters that Dillian White will have faced in his resume. So, you know, before we push Dillian White ahead, you know, of Helenius, we also have to give Helenius some respect, because he can also cause another upset during the night. So, you know, I think it's a very, very good fight, very good matchup. You know, I think for Dillian White, it enables him to remain active and to cement his position as a contender for the world title fights. And for Helenius, it could be a way to announce himself as another threat in the heavyweight division. So, you know, either way, I think we're going to have a very good night of heavyweight boxing. And I look forward to that fight, because, you know, Helenius did fight Derek Chisora. And it was a controversial decision, because Chisora had won that fight, but the victory was awarded to Helenius. So it would be good to see how Dillian White fares up against Helenius and whether he's able to knock him out. Now, if Dillian White is able to knock out Helenius, then we have a serious heavyweight that's asking a lot of questions. And for me, Dillian White needs to put himself in a position where no one can argue and everybody has to give him his just due. It's just that how he should be, you know?
He's just got to win his fights, that's all.
Please, yes.
Don Simmons, anything you might add on Dillian White, you know, becoming a WBC champion and fighting Joshua maybe in the future?
It'd be nice to see that fight, to be fair.
Yeah. Did he enjoy the first fight?
Yeah, it was alright. I do remember it, actually. It was a good fight. Good fight. But I ain't really got much to say on it, to be fair.
Yeah,
well, I think that would be good to see a second fight between them two.
It was a good scrap, you know, the bad blood between the two. Let's face it, that really sold the fight. And if you remember when his team jumped in the ring and then Joshua's team jumped in the ring, mate, I don't know about you, I want to see that again.
Yeah, it'll be great. Bit of entertainment.
That's it.
Yeah.
Beef sells.
That's it.
Beef sells.
All there to see a fight, right?
That's it. Brixton versus Watford. All good. Right, so we're going to move on. Announcement this week is Frank Buglioni fighting against Craig Richards. Now, Pascal.
Wait.
Mate, I wasn't expecting this one. It's going to be a bit tough to watch these two nice guys fight each other, but there has to be only one winner.
Yes, the white guy against the spider. You know,
two lovely guys. Great guys.
Very, very good boxers that, you know, we follow very much at Pep Talk and we like very much.
Good friends of the show. Yep.
Two gentlemen. You know, and it's a very difficult one, you know, it's difficult to talk about it, but I think for the sake of us listeners, we have to assess the fight and we have to be objective, you know, and, you know, I'm a bit concerned for Craig Richards because it could be a bit too early. You know,
he only fought last weekend as well.
Of course, you know, he took this fight on a very short notice, but we know that Craig, as you guys say in England, stays ready, you know.
He says, we working.
He stays ready, so we know that Craig will be there in tip-top condition. And also Buglioni, trained by Don Charles, will also be very much ready to take on whatever Craig has to offer. So, you know, it could be a very intriguing matchup. It will also be an opportunity for Craig, you know, to announce himself a bit more in the mainstream, you know, for the casual boxing fans who don't know Craig Richards very well, because Buglioni has been at various, you know, attempts at world title shots. He's fought in various places. He's fought in Wembley. He's fought in that O2 arena for various titles, defending British titles, you know, defending WBO European titles and so on. So he has fought at a very high level. So the public, and generally most people are aware of Frank Buglioni and of his achievements, but for Craig Richards it will be an opportunity for him to showcase his talent, to showcase his skills. So I'm looking forward to that fight, because, you know, arguably the winner of those two could potentially go on to fight Anthony Yard of Frank Warren's promotion. So that will be also a very good matchup, some very good matches to be made. But how do I assess the fight? Well, you know, you got Frank Buglioni's experience against Craig Richards' hunger.
experience at the weight as well, at light heavyweight.
At light heavyweight, also is very much experienced. You know, he's been there for much longer than Craig Hedges has. So you know, in terms of he's got accustomed to the weight, he's acclimatized to the weight, and you know, he's fought a lot of rounds at that weight, whereas Craig, you know, has not got the same level of experience. Yeah. But Craig is still very much a talented boxer, and he certainly will go out there and perform, and he will look at this as an opportunity to get a title. So it's very hard to call this one, Frankie B, but you know, my head would say that Buglioni could potentially edge it because of his experience, because he's been there and the pressure on him will be less. You know, Craig might potentially find the event quite overwhelming, and the fact that he's only just fought last week, you know, Bernard Hopkins always says that after a fight, it's important for the boxers to de-stress and to relax and to recover, mm-hmm. because, you know, the training and the fighting puts a lot on the body. So for me, the fact that Craig hasn't had enough recovery time could be a concern for me, you know, if I was his trainer, if I was in his corner. So on that basis, I'll give Buglioni the opportunity, the edge on that, an opportunity to perhaps win a split decision, you know, on that fight. I don't believe that Buglioni will knock out Craig. I believe that he'll be a good boxing match, you know, end to end fight. And I think that whatever the outcome, you know, it will be a very good fight. But I'm edging towards Frank on that one.
Well, you know what? Either way, Craig Richards, you know, I admire the fact that he's taken the fight at such short notice. And I really think he's going to go in there and give a good account of himself. You know, he's got nothing to lose.
Wait, of course.
And you know what they say? Never underestimate a man that has nothing to lose. You know?
That's very true. That's very true.
And what happens if he wins?
If he wins, the sky's the limit for him.
Exactly. Sky's the limit. So, two nice guys. I'm going to sit on the fence of this one. I like both guys. May the best man win. Now it's interview time. So there's a big night of boxing at the Principality Stadium where Anthony Joshua will take on Carlos Takam. We are this week in an interview segment supporting the boxing talent that's on the undercard. Now, breaking this week was the news that Frank Buglioni will defend his British light heavyweight title against Craig Spider Richards after a late withdrawal by the Commonwealth champion Callum Johnson. Now, let's hear from the wise guy himself, Frank Buglioni. It's Pep Talk UK. I'm Frankie B, and I'm joined by the British light heavyweight champion, which is Frank Buglioni. How you doing, mate?
Yeah, very well, thank you.
So is it Buglioni or Biglioni? I need to work on my Italian, mate.
It's Buglioni, silent G.
Buglioni. There you go. Grazie. Grazie.
Grazie.
So, Frank, big night of boxing this weekend. You're on the bill. You were meant to be fighting for the Commonwealth, but things have happened, and Callum Johnson's had to pull out. But now you're fighting Craig Richards. How does the game plan? Does it change at all?
Not so much. I've trained very hard. Callum Johnson, undefeated Commonwealth champion, good solid fighter. So no, I put the work in, and I had plenty of high quality sparring partners come in. In my opinion, some of them better than Callum Johnson. Quite a few of them better than Callum Johnson. And no disrespect to Craig Richards, but I would put the guys I've been sparring a level above him as well. So my sparring has been second to none in my training camp. It's gone perfect.
At such a late stage, having this withdrawal from Callum Johnson, do you have to change anything at all to adjust to Craig Richards?
Not so much. Craig Richards is a very similar fighter to like a Jose Burton, so I kind of know the tactics. I know what he does well. I know what he doesn't. I had plenty of spars with him, so I know him firsthand. I know he'll be well up for this fight, but no different to me, and I've got the experience on him. I've had people pull out late notice and change their opponents last minute, so I've dealt with it in the past and I'll deal with it again now.
So what about, you talked about experience, obviously Craig Richards is coming up a weight class and you've been at your weight for quite a while now. Does that give you more of an advantage?
Yeah, without a doubt. Down the home stretch, that weight plays a big role. I knew what it felt like at super middleweight when I was drained, and how much better I felt at light heavyweight. So Craig will be experiencing a little bit of that. He won't be so drained. But that being said, it's taken me 18 months to really kind of fill into the weight. So for him, it's only been a couple of weeks. He's up against it. But what this presents for him is a massive opportunity. He's got nothing to lose. He'll come in, he'll do his very best, and he'll learn a hell of a lot whilst he's in there, but he won't be coming out with a decision or the result that he wants.
Okay, crack yourself. Well, you mentioned Jose Burton. He's come out to the press and he said that basically, you know, you offered him as a last-minute replacement for Callum Johnson, and he said that you've turned it down and he's lost all respect and this and that. What's your thoughts on those comments that were put out?
It's simple, really. When he become British champion, he had a voluntary, and I called him out over and over again, but they just completely ignored me, him and Gallagher. And they said, get in line, you have to earn your shot. So what I had to do is I had to wait and get into a mandatory position. So, Jose Burton, the same goes for you. I'm not going to give you my voluntary. You didn't give me yours. So, get into your mandatory position and I'll gladly fight you. But, until then, you can get to the back of the queue.
That story's going to run and run and run, and I'm sure there will be a Jose Burton Big Leone Part 2 in the future. Now, we are a boxing and football podcast, and you've just admitted to me that you're a Chelsea fan. Now, I won't hold that against you, mate, but give me your assessment on the season so far for Chelsea.
They got off to a decent start. It's been a little bit hit and miss recently. But yeah, Chelsea, they always seem to be up there, and Conte's doing a great job. I think there's a little bit of a clash between the chairman and the board and the manager. So hopefully they can iron that out, because it'd be a great shame to lose Conte, and I think we're doing really well under him, so maybe give him a little bit more free rein. But yeah, it's politics. There's always politics in sport.
Politics in boxing, politics in football. Frank, it's been cracking having a bit of time with you, and we wish you the best of luck come fight night at the Principality Stadium in Cardiff, mate. All the best.
Frankie, thanks very much for your time, and great interview. Cheers, mate.
Cracking, mate, cracking. Right, let's hear from the challenger, who was in buoyant mood to take the British title. It's Craig Spider Richards. We work in...
Pep Talk UK are joined by a fella who doesn't do things by halves, doesn't make it easy for himself, but he's a man on a mission, he's always working. It's Mr. Craig Spider Richards. How are you doing, Spider?
I'm good as always. How are you?
Craig, I'm well. Last we met up was at York Hall. You were supposed to be fighting. Mm-hmm. That never happened. Yes. Clear out why that fight never took place.
My opponent messed his weight up and coming a bit too light, so the fight got pulled.
Now, I know you had a lot of fans that were due to come down to see you. You only found out on the day of the fight
yes.
that it was going to be...
About 2 hours before.
2 hours before. Now, it was a next-gen show.
Yes.
But now you're treating fights like buses.
Yeah.
You had one in Belfast, and now you got one, a small little fight, on Saturday.
Yes.
In Cardiff.
Yes.
Are you becoming an international jet setter?
Well, that's what it is.
Belfast, fighting in Cardiff.
I like to take it from a throwback. I like to fight whenever I can, whoever I can, whenever. A lot of people worry about full preparations and camps and all this and that, or risking it all. You see, I like to fight. I like to get in there and fight, and that's what it's about. It's about trying to win all the titles and make my way up the ladder. So as soon as I heard, I was like, yeah, let's make it happen.
Frank's a worthy opponent.
Mm-hmm.
He's a champion. He's a British champion.
Yes.
Any special prep you're doing, or are you just taking him as another fighter?
Another fighter. Two arms, two legs, head. It's another fighter.
Occasion, 80,000 people going to be there, or so, at Cardiff, but you're not a stranger to the big hall fights. You've already done the O2.
Yes, done O2 a couple of times, the Wembley Arena, Copper Box, York Hall. I led the show at York Hall, main event. Was well over capacity for, so I'm not stranger to the crowds, all the eyes, the bright lights. I've been there.
Now, you've got an army of fans that always turn up everywhere.
Yes.
Short notice, how much of an army are you taking with you at Cardiff?
As much as we can, so just got to get everyone down to Cardiff, let the message out ASAP and let everyone, make sure everyone comes down and comes and support, shouts loud. So that's what it's about, really.
How's Jody going to sound amongst 80,000 people?
She'll outdo them all.
Are you sure?
Like, she's enough.
It's a big stadium, are we going to hear Jody Richards screaming?
Yes, you're going to hear her over,
come on,
the whole, over the whole crowd.
Now, Jody, something I do know, you and do you ever get involved in a bit of sparring at home?
Nah, we don't spar. she'll hurt me.
That's it, Jody, you hear that? We were nice to you, we were very nice to you. Come Saturday, we'll be cheering you on. We wish you the best of luck.
Thank you.
Just let me know one thing, where's that belt going Saturday night?
Back here, strap season, round my waist.
Love you, Craig. You have a great one. Good luck with the fight, good luck with fight week, and we'll catch up with you Saturday night.
Thank you.
Cheers, buddy.
Bye. Buglioni versus Richards. Let's go. Finally, let's hear from another fighter on the undercard. It's the exciting light heavyweight, Joshua Buatsi.
Right, it's Pep Talk, it's Frankie B, and I'm joined by the light heavyweight sensation, which is Joshua Buatsi. How you doing, Geese?
I'm blessed, man, I'm blessed. I've just come from training camp, my body's aching, but I've just seen my best mate win his sixth professional fight, so I'm buzzing, man.
Just under a week, we've got the massive, massive bill, Joshua versus Takam, who loves yam. And you're on the bill.
Yeah, I'm on the bill. I hope I'm looking in shape anyways.
You look war ready.
Yeah, a week to go, so I'm feeling good. I'm near the weight already, so a week away from weighing, and then Saturday I'll be under the lights, yeah.
So how's preparations gone at that up in Sheffield?
I'm everywhere. I'm in Sheffield, I'm in London, everywhere where I can get good sparring and some good work, that's where I am. So there's not really a place I can be located at, that's the thing about me. So where there's good work, I'm there getting it in, I'm there improving, learning. So it's been going well, I can't complain. It's been a long camp, so I'm glad that it's over. In fact, I'm not glad, I'm not just glad, I'm very, very happy that it's over. Fight week is just going to be calm, relaxed, weight management, weigh in, eat, get ready to do the business. So it's all good, man.
Do you know much about your opponent that you're going to be fighting at the Principality Stadium?
To be honest, I don't. And it's, I think, I'm at...
So you're going to have to do your Googles, yeah?
Yeah, no, but the thing is, I'm at that level where I've just started, so...
Yeah.
They're not going to be big names, if I'm honest, and they might come in last minute or they might get some notice, but I'm preparing to... I train to improve boxing all the time, so I might be boxing Bob, but it might change to Johnny the next day. It doesn't bother me. I'm just preparing to put on a show, to perform, do you know what I mean? So it doesn't really... I don't think much about it.
Okay, you seem like the type of guy that always stays ready anyway.
Yeah, have to.
So basically, you know, assuming that's a formality, where are you looking at for 2018?
I look to get out once again before the year finishes. So Hay and Bellew, that would be the ideal card to be on. That's not confirmed yet, but it's something, it's a show. It's in London as well. I'm from London, so why not? And then in 2018, I'll just keep on progressing on. I don't think... When people like give time frames and stuff like that, that's cool. If that's them, that's them. But for me, I never give time frames. I just constantly look for improvement and progression. As long as I'm moving forward all the time, then so be it. And that's what I'm going to keep doing. So in terms of time frames and who I want to box and when I'm going to box them, I couldn't tell you that. I'm just in the gym making sure I'm improving and making sure that most importantly I live up to the expectations, but more importantly that I surpass the expectation. So the expectation is there, the hype is there, cool. I know I've got a job to do, so that's all I'm concentrating about.
So it's all about the Principality Stadium, Joshua Buatsi. Thanks for your time. All the best come fight night, mate.
Thank you very much. Thanks, everyone.
Cracking stuff.
My G. Cracking stuff. So now it's football time. Right, boys, it's time to talk the footy. Premiership is back on the weekend once more. Now, the biggest match that we're going to feature is Manchester United at Old Trafford versus the Spurs. Right, now Don Simmons.
Yeah.
I know you're a gooner, but you're going to have to talk about Tottenham and you're going to have to talk about Man United.
I don't watch football.
You play it, you don't watch it. A lot of footballers might be fed up with the fact that they play it, so they don't watch it. I can can understand that.
Hey, you can't watch it and play at the same time, do you know what I mean?
But you know, we're going to do a few predictions. Obviously, Man United, they, you know, they're coming off a loss, a surprise loss to Huddersfield, which was really a surprise around, you know, the whole of the Premiership. But Spurs, you know, they're always looking pretty strong. Harry Kane's on fire, and you know, you being part of the strikers union, you know, I think you can relate to a man that's, you know, bang on form, and Harry Kane.
He's not wasting no time, Harry Kane. He's doing so well. I can see Tottenham winning this.
Yeah. Wow, at Old Trafford. Really?
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Because they got this whole togetherness as a unit, as a team. You know, and when your striker's on form like that, all you've got to do is put that ball in a box and he will do the rest. Because he's high on confidence right now. So as long as he don't get injured, he will score maybe 2 goals against Man United. I can see Tottenham winning.
Wow. The only thing is, I don't think Mourinho will allow Man United to lose 2 games in a row. Could you imagine the jumping up and down in the dressing room?
As long as he don't kick a football boot at any of the players.
Yeah, he'll go absolutely bananas, mate. Yeah. But it should be an entertaining game. These are the games that make the Premiership so interesting. You know?
Yeah.
But MJ, your prediction? Man United or Spurs?
I'm actually going to have to go with United on this one. Either United or...
As a Liverpool fan? Wow.
No, listen, not as a Liverpool fan. Just knowing Jose Mourinho, he's going to absolutely ruin... I tell you what, I'm still sore from what Spurs did to us at Wembley. I was actually at Wembley last weekend.
That was a smackdown.
Yeah, it was... I mean, Dejan Lovren, they paid him. That's the reason why. So, yeah, if you must know. Because if we didn't have Lovren on the pitch, I guarantee you we'd have beaten him 4-0.
Well, he had some jollof rice before the game, innit? That's why he was lacking pace.
To be honest, listen, I don't know what's wrong with the brother. You got to speak to Lovren, because apparently he deleted his social media. Because that's what Spurs are out here doing to people. They're forcing them to retire from social media. So, look out, Romelu Lukaku or Eric Bailly or someone, because that's what Spurs are doing. After Spurs play you, players are actually just like literally locking up social media. They don't want the publicity. But no, actually, going back to this game, I just see Mourinho actually defending their guns with that quality of David De Gea and Harry Kane and Lukaku. They've kind of been throwing subliminals at each other for the last, I don't know, 18 months or something like that. I remember when Lukaku was interviewed last season, when they asked him who was going to win the top goal scorer in the Premier League, when he thought Harry Kane was going to be out long term. And they asked him, do you watch Harry Kane to learn about striking and stuff? And his answer was no. I watched Ibrahimovic or Lewandowski, like, who is Harry Kane? Pretty much. So they were going back and forth, and obviously Kane won that golden boot. So, you know, in the back of Lukaku's mind, especially since he's received all this criticism, he doesn't score against top teams.
I actually see
this being such a big game, and United actually showing up, especially since Spurs have got Real Madrid next as well. So I just see Spurs going through a stacked period, and I see them just losing out on this one, because after Liverpool, the high of Liverpool, they've got United and then Madrid at Wembley. So because for that reason, I'm going to go 2-1 Manchester United.
United. Oh, did I just say that?
That's worrying.
That is worrying. You see, Arsenal, they disappoint me so much, man. I find myself doing another chance, mate. You know,
listen, I hope you're not ready to do a Van Persie.
Or Ozil, possibly. Pascal, predictions, please. Man United versus Spurs.
My predictions, you know, like I said last week, you know, that Liverpool will be losing to Tottenham. You know, everybody said it was going to be a draw, but I know Tottenham are very much a pain in the backside. You know, they are there to cause trouble, and they will cause trouble against Jose Mourinho. When Mourinho found out what is the next game after this Huddersfield defeat, he was very pissed off, because, you know, he thought that he was going to go to Huddersfield and win and take 3 points, because Mourinho looks at the Premier League like a multiplication table, and he can't predict the points that he's going to get. He certainly did not foresee that his team losing to Huddersfield, and there will be more of those results, Manchester United fans, believe you me, there will be more of those. And I believe that come Saturday, Tottenham are known to be better playing away than they are playing at home. Now, let's look at
this. That's a fact, yeah.
Let's look at it objectively. They did remarkably better than I expected them to do against Real Madrid. They played a very good game. They almost won the game at Real Madrid.
Yep.
They disciplined Liverpool. It was a complete discipline. Like,
it
you
was
know,
some Mr. Miyagi like, stuff, man.
It was a very spanking
voice.
You know, the trousers were pulled down and they beat Liverpool with a baseball bat at the back of the backside.
With a baseball bat.
Monsieur MJ, s'il vous plaît, it's my turn to speak. So, Liverpool were shaped totally wonderful. And for me, if I was a Spurs fan, and if I was a Spurs player, I could take a lot of positive from the games against very big clubs. So what would prevent Portuguese men to go to Old Trafford and say, look guys, let's go there for a draw? No, we are coming here to win the game. We know that Manchester United lost to Huddersfield. Mourinho has to respond. There is no way that if Mourinho has any, if Mourinho is listening to this podcast, if he has any kahunas, he would not be ending at Old Trafford. He'd be going straight at Tottenham to go and win the game. So we will have to see what kind of character Manchester United would display on Saturday. And if Mourinho plays a defensive team, I'm sorry, but we can only say that Manchester United are puss in boots. That's it. You know, it has to be a game that they have to win. So I'm very excited about this game, Frankie B, because I would like to see how United respond against their defeat and whether they'll go at Tottenham, knowing that we have a Tottenham side that is very good at counter football, and also we have a player in Harry Kane that is completely on fire and I can score at any given moment. So for me, it's a foregone conclusion. Spurs are going to win, and it's going to be 2-1 victory for Spurs.
2-1 victory. Just staying with you, Don, as a striker, I bet you would have fancied your chances against Lovren last weekend.
I'll score the hat-trick.
Guys, what do you think it is with Lovren? Is it just pace?
On the United. Yeah.
Go on, MJ.
I was just going to speak on the United defeat to Huddersfield, because Jose Mourinho struggles against people who play high press, high tempo. And that he probably had a sneaky suspicion that he was actually going to struggle against Huddersfield, because against Jurgen Klopp, it's played eight. Mourinho has only ever won twice, and the one time he won was actually when Borussia Dortmund had already beaten Real Madrid so badly in the first leg of the semi-finals that the second leg didn't matter. It was 2-1 win. And the chap at Huddersfield is actually Jurgen Klopp's former defensive coach and actually one of his top coaches from the time at Dortmund. So he very much plays in that high press mold. So it wasn't that as big a shock, the fact that his team struggled, because the way Mourinho sets up, he can't really go toe-to-toe against high press teams. So in a way, I mean, we should kind of not pay too much attention to the Huddersfield defeat. Spurs are still going to be ready to actually play, but United should be super strong and ready for this one.
We will see. I don't see Man United losing two games in a row, I've got to be honest. So I'll go for Man United based upon Mourinho is a very intelligent manager and he corrects mistakes. That's what I like about him, to be fair. So Man United are going to win 1-2 this weekend. Now, moving on, Arsenal versus Swansea at the Emirates. Now, Don, you're an Arsenal fan. I know you're proud to admit that, you know, the Gooners.
Yeah.
How do you see this game going? You know, Arsenal, again, you know, when you think they're on the road after just beating Everton, you know, these are the type of games Arsenal can surprise us and let us down.
Yeah, it's possible. It all depends how they start the game. Do you know what I mean? They're so unpredictable sometimes, Arsenal. And that's why I ain't really been watching them, because they get on my nerves. Do you know what I mean? There's games where they should win, end up losing. Games where they should win, end up drawing. So it'll be interesting. Obviously, I was proud of our last game, our result and everything else. And it's just consistency now. Just got to keep the winning mentality, you know, and keep the togetherness. have to be in it together. Fans, players, all got to stick together.
Yeah. Well, were you one of these people that was Wenger in or out?
No, Wenger in.
You was in?
Wenger in.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, 100%.
Well, that's the first one we've had in the show. Wow.
Do you know why? Like, it's the players. You can't be blaming the manager. All right, it's a manager as well. But there's a lot of players in the team. It's about the players coming together. You know, Arsene Wenger can't go on the pitch and kick the ball. But he coaches his team, he manages his players. Yeah. So but, it's all about the players.
But it's all about the players. But, Don, he puts Bellerin on the left, yeah, and Chamberlain was on the right early in the season. That is not going to help the team. Then he buys a lot of players that are very similar, like all number 10s, with a lack of defensive midfielder. These are not the players. This is the manager's decision.
Yeah, true. He is the one that brings them in. Obviously, you know, he's a successful manager. He's done well. And he's good, you know, with choosing what players to come in. Do you know what I mean? Because there's always players coming in. There's always players leaving also. So he knows what he's doing. All right, for us as fans, don't look too good. But then when they're doing stuff on the pitch and they start winning and start playing together, people ain't really got much to say after that. Do you know what I mean? Sometimes you just got to hold tight and just go with the flow and see what happens.
Yeah. So, you're confident that Wenger will bring back the Premier League to Arsenal?
What, this season?
Well, sometime in the next two years.
Well, that's the thing. Like,
are you putting mortgage on it? Yeah?
Nah, never. You know what? It'll be nice, isn't it, to win the Premier League. But I can't see it happening this year. And, you know, I don't want him to go, but it might be about time for a fresh start, a new change.
Or
it could be. Yeah, au revoir.
So they're winning this game against Swansea? They're winning?
Is it a away game, you said, or home game?
Home game.
Oh, yeah, we're winning. I say my predictions will be 3-0 Arsenal.
3-0. The AOL
Sanchez,
partnership.
Sanchez goal, and Danny Boy. Well bet.
Yeah, Danny Boy, if he comes back. Pascal.
Wait.
Will we see the AOL partnership, Alexis, Ozil and Lacazette partnership firing again at the Emirates?
I believe so, because I believe that you know, for that there is some attention given to the fans, and you know, and a lot of the fans have said the first time that those players have played together, you know, they destroyed Everton.
It was electrifying.
Everton, not
yeah,
the best.
It was.
Mm-hmm. It wasn't the best team, but you know, you've got pace and technicality mixed into one, and it was exhilarating to watch. Despite the minor setback with the Wayne Rooney goal, there was certainly a better momentum from the team, and it got me a bit excited. You know, I had a semi erection watching the game, because it was like this is fantastic. This
sexy
is
football, yeah.
Sexy football. I was fixated, because this is the kind of football that we'll be crying for. Now, in terms of what is going to happen on Saturday, I mean, you know, in the background, Frankie B, there's a bit of a concern about the Arsenal board and whether the board will be re-elected. You know, so the fans are asking for the board, some of the members of the board to step down. So behind the scenes, there's a lot of controversy. There's a lot of concern. Hopefully this will not permeate into the team on Saturday. The players will do what they're supposed to do and carry a good job. Swansea have always been a temperamental team for Arsenal, you know. They tend to turn up against Arsenal. For whatever reason, we've never really dominated Swansea. But if it's a home game, I expect Arsenal to win. But who will be starting? And this is my concern, because they may well be, you know, Wenger may decide to put Giroud instead of the team
rotate.
That, you know, there's this rotation, and we're not sure what Wenger is going to do, because he's so unpredictable. We don't know. He's like the British weather. One day it's hot, the next day it rains. We don't understand what's going on. And Arsenal on Saturday could be that game, you know, where Giroud completely could be part of the squad. Against Norwich, it was quite difficult for Giroud to even play, because he didn't manage to score any of the goals. But, you know, we don't I'm just worried that Wenger, you know, would tinker with the team on Saturday. For me, he should keep on with, if he's found a winning formula, he should keep to that team and see how well they can do, because there's a lot of momentum that we need to galvanize, we need to put together. We have some very difficult games coming up against Manchester City, against Tottenham, and yeah, we need to see whether
next week,
that,
Man City.
That, of course, and that trio needs to stick together, but Wenger will think about next week and will make up some excuse that not there. What if Ozil gets injured? What if Alexis gets injured? And he will start to play players that should not be playing. I believe always play your strongest team. Always play your strongest team. So for me, I want to see the Lacazette, Ozil and Sanchez starting that game. And I want them to win and to do really well. If Arsenal are 3-0 up in the first half, then we can start changing the players and bring in the likes of Jack Wilshere, Alexi Iwobi can come on and you give them a chance to play the game, you know. But my prediction is 3-0 for Arsenal. They'll win that game 3-0 comfortably.
3-0.
Wait, right. Yep.
MJ, your score prediction?
Fancy B, you know what? It's actually funny, Pascal, what he just said about Olivier Giroud, because he's definitely going to start Olivier Giroud come this weekend. Giroud just won the Francis Puskas Award for the best
goal.
No,
that'll be his excuse.
For awards, for the Scorpion kick. He actually did win the best goal last year for the FIFA Awards, so he picked up an amazing trophy for that. But the reason why Wenger will start Giroud come Saturday is because everyone going on about AOL, when Sanchez is cooked, if he sells Sanchez in January or whatever happens in the summer, people are going to start pointing fingers at Wenger. For this reason, Arsene Wenger does not need the AOL to be successful. Because if the AOL gets successful and Arsenal fans start getting really excited, everyone's going to turn around and say, hang on, whose fault is it that the AOL is not secure for next season? And for that reason alone, Giroud will definitely start on Saturday. But having said that, Arsenal will have too much for Swansea. I see it being 2-0. Arsenal scoring 2 goals and, what's it called? Alexis Sanchez being amongst the goals and actually keeping a clean sheet. 2-0 Arsenal, I'm going for.
Yeah. And then Giroud will score, and that will justify his decision to drop Lacazette. Okay, I understand. Okay, cracking stuff. Right, guys, we're going to move on finally to Liverpool versus Huddersfield. Now, MJ, staying with you here. This is your team, mate. Take the floor away.
Absolutely.
Are you going to recover?
Well, basically, we're going up against David Wagner, who is obviously Jurgen Klopp's former go-to guy. So yeah, so both managers know each other pretty damn well. They both play that high press football, and Jurgen Klopp is not really going to want to actually lose one over his mate. It's going to be a difficult game because Huddersfield are high on confidence and Liverpool are shattered to two pieces. We're going to have to find a back four from somewhere, especially with having taken off Dejan Lovren off at Wembley after 20 minutes. And he's the only, well, I suppose we got Clavan, but we don't have a lot of senior centre-halves. We only have 3 senior centre-halves at Liverpool for whatever reason, because Klopp got rid of Sacco and didn't sign VVG or anybody else. So it's going to be a very tough game. But if you push me for a prediction, I'm going to shock you and go for a Liverpool win. We're going to win 2-0. We're going to keep a clean sheet to silence some of the doubters and actually score 2 goals. Mohamed Salah being amongst the goals and Bobby Firmino.
Ooh. We'll see. We'll see if they'll make a recovery. This is the exact type of game that Liverpool might slip up on. Don? Liverpool or Huddersfield?
Just like MJ just said, Huddersfield's high on confidence at the moment, so my prediction's actually a draw, maybe 0-0 or 1-1.
Wow.
That's my predictions.
Wow. MJ, I know you won't like that, but you know, it is what it is. Pascal, quick prediction.
Because I like to make MJ happy, I will go for Huddersfield are going to win again against another big team. You know, Huddersfield could be the team this season that takes the scalps of the big teams, you know. And and if I'm not mistaken, did Huddersfield beat Chelsea this season?
No, they didn't.
Or
no,
who
they
else?
Didn't.
It was Burnley, sorry, I do apologize. It was Burnley, it was one of those smaller teams. But look, you know, at the end of their day, the excitement of the Premier League is that it's so unpredictable. And the teams that should put, that are supposed to be putting the teams away, certainly end up the ones losing. And Huddersfield are very much looking forward to that Liverpool game, I'm telling you. With the clowns in defense in Mignolet and Lovren, you know, it's going to make it very, very comfortable for them. You know, they're going to be very comfortable, you know, playing against Liverpool. As long as they can withstand the pressure of Liverpool, who play very high pressing football, all it takes is 25 minutes to contain them. And after that, the wall is breached. And I expect Huddersfield to repeat what they've done against Manchester United and score against Liverpool. Because the way to assess it is, can Huddersfield score against Liverpool? Yes, they can. So if they can score once, they can score twice.
And quote Obama. Twice, yes, we can.
Yes, of course. Yes, they can. That could be, that should be the slogan, you know. But they can score. And the problem against Liverpool is they've not addressed the defensive blunders, the defensive frailties for a very long time. And it is obvious. It is obvious as anyone, you know, knows that just as Donald Trump is not fit to be president, the Liverpool defense is not fit to be playing Premier League football at this level. It's shocking defending. And this has to be addressed sooner than later. And Jurgen Klopp, as good as he did, you know, has not addressed the defensive frailties of the team. So I believe that teams like Huddersfield and other teams throughout the season will be exposing that. You know, so for me, Liverpool could certainly be falling away from that top four, you know, and we also get closer to January with the likes of Coutinho having an eye, you know, closer to the new camp also. So it could be curtains.
Wow, it sounds like Armageddon for Liverpool.
Well, I tell you what, I'm definitely going to be walking forwards because Pascal's ready to put the knife in at every
you know, Pascal hates Liverpool, you know? With a passion. Right, guys, that's our time. I'd like to thank Don Simmons, Pascal, and MJ. Join us again next week for another Pep Talk UK podcast. Don't forget to please hit the subscribe button and leave your comments. Thank you. Pep Talk UK.